So the face, particularly the eyes, are said to be the windows to the rest of the society with regards to the patient's level of health, tiredness, and as well as interest in others. Hence, many health professionals consider the periorbital area of the face as the most important area of the rejuvenation. Nowadays, people are very much interested in periorbital rejuvenation because that is the first area where whenever we look at somebody, that is the area where your attention goes. So aesthetic surgery has become an increasingly important part of the oculoplastic surgery. The oculoplastic surgeons does not any longer confine themselves to the region around the eye, but also performs aesthetic surgery on forehead, on lower face, and carries out the mid-face lift. The dermatologists, oral maxillofacial surgeons, comprehensive plastic surgeons, as well as the comprehensive ophthalmologists are also active in conducting this craft. So the periorbital rejuvenation can be divided into either a surgical rejuvenation procedures or the non-surgical rejuvenation procedures. Surgical ones include the blepharoplasty and the browplasty. Blepharoplasty is again the upper and the lower lid blepharoplasty, and recently they have also added the canthoplasty. The non-surgical rejuvenation procedures are the botulinum toxin, fillers, peels, lasers, microneedling, etc. Now to understand the need, we need to know the pathogenesis of the aging face. Now there are both the intrinsic factors and the extrinsic factors. So the intrinsic factors, we do not have any control. This is normal chronological programmed aging. And the extrinsic factors, we can have a little bit of control over it, like smoking, UV radiations, and all these in together in total lead to the involutional facial changes. So as the face ages, what happens is the soft tissue component moves inferiorly and the bone component loses the mass, and so leaving the soft tissue to hang from its attachments to the bone. So there are two types of changes which occur as we age. Now around the eyes also and all over the face, there are two types of changes which are occurring. One are static changes, which is the component is usually because of the volume loss, and they remain stationary even when we are at rest. The dynamic changes are the changes in the muscle tone due to constant movement of the specific muscle. So the earliest age manifestation is the lateral brow ptosis, but it usually doesn't occur alone and is usually accompanied with the dermatocallosis and the upper eyelid ptosis. Dermatocallosis is actually a mere skin redundancy of the upper eyelids hanging on or even beyond the eyelashes, mostly because of the aging. There is something called golden ratio. This is usually 1.6, which means a beautiful person's face is about 1 to 1/2 times longer than it is wider. So this golden ratio is being followed to know how aesthetically a person is. So this is an example. Now this is the horizontal is 1 and vertical is 1.6. So this is the golden ratio of the face. If we divide it horizontally, if we pass three lines, one in interpupillary area, base of the hairline, and then the base of the alar base and the chin. If this is 1:1:1, all these three parts are equal from here to here, here to here, and here to here. These three parts are equal. This is again the normal aesthetic face, and this is the formula which this is also a golden ratio, and this is what the people want to achieve. This is again a depiction of how this golden ratio works. Even in olden days, everyone knew about this. The Egyptians, they used to follow this rule. Nowadays even the photographers, they follow this rule. Now this is 1, this part is 1, and this part is 1.6. So this is the golden ratio which is being followed. So whenever this golden ratio is being followed, when we see a person or any building or anything, it looks aesthetically good. The drooping of the forehead skin with accompanying dermatocallosis leads to chronic use of frontalis muscle to elevate the eyebrows. Such a chronic contracture of the frontalis muscle leads to prominent transverse forehead rides. this is the example of the dermatocallosis, and such a severe, this is milder form of dermatocallosis, and this is such a severe dermatocallosis that this was hindering the view, the patient's vision. And so she has to elevate her eyebrows, and these are the wrinkles which are formed. Now, what is aesthetically normal? What should we achieve? The medial brow is an imaginary line drawn perpendicular to the alar base. The lateral brow terminates at the oblique line extending from the alar base to passing through the lateral canthus. And the superior orbital margin is line 3. So the female eyebrow is positioned above the orbital rim and is arched with its apex between the lateral limbus and the lateral canthus. And the male brow is flatter and fuller, which runs over the superior orbital rim without any peak. So this, if there's a male, we need to achieve this. And if it's a female, we need to achieve this. Now, something about normal brow. The eyebrow is made up of head, body, and tail. The horizontal length of the brows can measure 5 to 5.5 centimeters with a width of 1.3 to 1.5 centimeters. It generally has an upward contour at the head and a downward contour at the tail. The medial brow should begin at the supraorbital rim and laterally end at the oblique line extending from the alar base through the lateral canthus. The highest peak, again, it is the repetition. Highest peak of the brow should be at the junction of the middle and the lateral one-third. A brow extending above the orbital rim is a sign of beauty, but a lower brow is aesthetically not desirable. Little bit about the lid anatomy. The eyelid structures consists mainly of three layers. A thin skin layer, which is the outermost layer overlying the tarsus and the preceptal areas. The middle layer includes the orbital septum and the orbicularis oculi muscle, and the tarsal plate and palpebral conjunctiva provide a frictionless surface on the inner layer of the eyelid. Now, this is a structure. This is the tarsal plate, conjunctiva, the muscle, and the outermost layer. Now, how do we know that this is a normal lid or a ptotic lid? How do we decide whether we need to do something about it, whether it is ptotic? So the upper eyelid ptosis or the blepharoptosis is evaluated by measuring either the palpebral. There are two parameters by which we can decide whether it's a blepharoptosis or not. So it is either you measure the palpebral fissure height, which is normally 10 millimeter, or we can measure MRD1 is margin reflex distance 1, which is 4 to 4.5 millimeter normally. So measurement of MRD1 allows more accurate assessment of the upper eyelid ptosis than the measurement of the palpebral fissure height, as the MRD1 is the independent of lower eyelid position. So measurements with value of lesser than this lowest normal limit can signify upper lid ptosis, that is value of less than 10 of palpebral fissure height or less than 4 millimeter of MRD1. This, if this is there, then it is considered to be a ptotic lid. So if we see here, so this is the total palpebral fissure height, which is around 10 millimeters. Now, because this lower lid can be slightly lower down, so this is not that accurate. But if we measure this, this is more accurate from the pupillary area to pupil to the margin. Now, the lower lid anatomically is same, except externally there are three fat pads in the lower lid. The bony configuration of the midface plays an important role. Level of medial and the lateral canthal tendons also play a role in deciding the aging process. The young females have a lateral canthal tilt. Now, if we go to the surgical rejuvenation procedures, now there are certain conditions where these surgical procedures are needed. This is the first condition where only the lacrimal gland prolapse is there. This is looking like dermatocallosis, but the difference is that here only the lateral part is hooded. And in dermatocallosis, whole of this lid is coming down or hanging. So this is just the lacrimal gland prolapse. And what we need to do is we need to push this lacrimal gland back and just give a suture from the conjunctival side. Now when we see the lower lid, so there are three areas which we need to see for. The soft tissue loss occurs at the sites where the bony ligaments attach to the skin. This occurs mainly in three places. The septal confluence is this, the yellow one. The orbital ligament, which forms the orbitomalar, this blue one. And the zygomatic ligament here, this is the green one. So these are the three protrusions which we can see, and we need to see which one is weaker. Now, if we consider, if we see as a whole, these are the three fat pads in the lower lid, and one and two are the fat pads in the upper lid, and this third one is the lacrimal gland prolapse. So the basic principles of this aesthetic oculoplastic surgery is that the cosmetic ocular surgery in the young patient primarily involves in the excisional fat sculpting without any skin removal from a heavy lower eyelid. Conversely, if there is a blepharoplasty which needs to be done in a mature phase, it requires restoration of the underlying structural integrity of the upper face, including the brows and the lids. This technique of shaping up of the lids is usually predictable, and it is technically straightforward. Considering the brow ptosis, the real amount of the brow ptosis is determined at rest and in resting position of the eyebrow with closed eyes and no contraction of the frontalis or the globular muscles. The brow ptosis can be defined as an eyebrow that either falls below the superior orbital rim or it extends less than 10 mm above the eyelid margin. In other words, the eyebrow ptosis should be considered when the upper lid height is less than 10 mm, or the in men it occurs when the distance between the mid of the pupil to the top of the brow is less than 2.5 cm. This is a picture showing a brow ptosis in a female and a male.